This is an incredible sense of vision. In excess of $2 billion, 1.6 coming in from the Commonwealth to make sure that we build on the vision that was started by Warren Truss, built on by Michael McCormick, continued on with Sam and myself, so that we, and Paul too, we better mention him, we'll get annoyed, won't give us any money. So this is important because our vision is that you can start in Melbourne and you start on a motorway, you go up along the Hume, you get to Sydney, you duck through Sydney now, the Connect, North Connect, back onto the M1, up here. We've got a bottleneck here. We're going to shove that out of the way. We're going to build through that, get that done. Continue on up to Coffs Harbour. We're stuck into Coffs Harbour. We're going to make sure we get that bypass done. Up on into Brisbane, through Brisbane, without a traffic light. Continue on up, up towards Gympie. Aboriginal word means stinging tree. Keep on going up right. Tauri bypass. This is the vision we have. And our vision will continue on. While coalition government is here, we're pushing on and we're going to go all the way, ultimately to Cairns, piece by piece. We're going to do that because we believe in this nation. We have a vision that for this nation. That's not just going north and south, it's east and west. We look at things such as the Outback Way, Boulia down to Laverton, towns you never heard of, but where your critical minerals are going to come from, where your gold's going to come from, through places such as Alice Springs, helping out people in those remote areas. But this is the big one. Listen to those, look at that traffic. I mean, you don't want that stopping at the traffic lights. They've got no interest in stopping. They want to go straight through. And that's our job. That's our job. Make this economy hum. Make these businesses grow. So 15 kilometres here, $2.1 billion, about 2,700 people working on the job. 2,700 people taking out 5 traffic lights. Hopefully we can. Hopefully that's all of them. I only found out we're taking out 5. Hopefully there's none left. Making sure that the road is safer, the road is quicker, and industry grows. So, great announcement. And I think we're also building on that. They've asked for a bit more money. We've stuck them a bit more money, about $80 million. I'm looking down the back to my advisors, $80 million. And that comes by the, you know, people saying, oh, well, what are we here for? Well, we're here to make sure it happens. We're building it. And when if more money is required, we're finding it. This is showing our attention. Our attention to the Hunter Valley, because we respect this. This joint generates money. It generates royalties. It generates business. The biggest export from this state comes out of there. The biggest export, all the royalties attached. And we understand that the commerce of the Hunter Valley is becoming its own mechanism. They don't talk about Sydney. They're interested in the Hunter. They're people of the Hunter, interested in the Hunter, building the Hunter. And we want to be in partnership with them, building the Hunter. We want to make sure that we respect the wealth that this area generates, we build on it, and we show respect for this area by investing in it. Right. Questions?
The original concept designs were drawn up in 2005. Why now is it becoming back?
Well, as concept designs are drawn up, it's taken us to come up with the money. We're drawn up with the money. We're working to a plan. We're working on a plan along the whole of the Pacific Highway. We've been driving this agenda forward. They've asked for more money, and we've found more money. It is not just here that we're working with the Hunter Valley. It's also the Singleton Bypass. Massive investment there. Massive investment. $770 million there. These guys, you're tipping in for the Muswellbrook Bypass. The whole vision for the Hunter, that whole intermodal capacity. We're building on it, it's happening, we're driving it forward. You've asked for more money, you're getting it.
The widening of the Hexham Strait, has there been any update on that from here to the bypass?
Well, if there's more information here, I'm going to let Sam Faraway say it, but within this process is the widening of that Hexham space. It's part of the process. We're making sure that the planning that has to be diligent to take into effect not only the traffic we've got, but the traffic we're going to get. The thing about these things is cities don't build roads, roads build cities. And as soon as you expand a road, the traffic goes in to meet it. But that also brings in the cash, it brings in the job, brings in the better standard of living. But Hexham, in writing the notes as we came along, the widening at Hexham is also part of this process.
Obviously, for a project here, in the Hunter, we want to see as many Hunter businesses get behind it and support it, given the COVID situation that we're dealing with, businesses struggling.
Yeah, well, what we also want to see is Australian companies as part of this process. One of my great goals as Minister for Infrastructure is to assist as much in the construction, not only of the roads, but of a Tier 1 construction company, Australian Tier 1. Now, we have to utilise the overseas Tier 1s, we have Tier 2s, but as we go forward with these sort of projects, we want to make sure that as much as we can, we get Australian content into building these. And so assist businesses and local businesses in, it's not just building the roads, the aggregates, the batch making plants, it's the subbies that are part of this process. We want to also make that that's part of the show. And as you well know, the more we build this, the more we build the road, you know, up towards Muswellbrook, on towards Scone, and ultimately on towards Tamworth, which ultimately is the epicentre of Australia.
Will these jobs go to local people?
Sorry?
Will these jobs go to local people?
Not all the jobs will go to local people, but local people will have it. It's, you know, we've got 2,700 people coming on, and the most logical people to employ are the people who are local, but it's got to come with the requisite skills, and there's some skill sets that you know, will come in from other areas, just like people from Newcastle go to other areas to do jobs.
Have you seen
a lot
of accidents on this
track? Yes, most definitely. That's the whole plan of it. I suppose back in Warren Truss's time, one of the seedbeds of this was the tragic bus crash that happened at Maxville, which was then, people thought it was an impossible project. The duplication, so that'll never happen. And it was the drive and the persistence by the Nationals and the Liberals to make sure that we said, no, we are going to duplicate it. And we start on the program, and we're finishing the program. You know, people talk about timing. We've gone from Sydney all the way to Brisbane, right across the border, duplicating it all the way. And there's been some massive things. If you go across the Clarence, the massive bridges in there, the duplication that goes past, that bypasses Grafton, areas where the road just stopped. You'd go along and think there's a breakdown. I'd go, no, that's just as fast as the traffic goes here, but We're now driving through. We're driving through to completion. And we don't see this as just one part. We see this as a major part of a massive plan that the Nationals and the Liberals have driven together to make sure we finalise it and bring about our goal.
The lack of rats in the area, should the government have moved a little bit quicker to get more rats in the
past? We're going to have, I think, next week, 16 million rats come in. Rapid antigen tests, and after that another 33 million turning up. We have been managing this process as it goes along. It's not just an issue for rapid antigen tests in Australia, it's an issue across the globe, and this issue we're managing as we manage a global pandemic, and we're making sure as we bring them in that the people who are most vulnerable are pensioners, people on concession card holders get it. We're also coming forward with a plan so you can get in batches, I think it's 10 over a month, five over 1 week, so that we try and make sure that everybody who wants access to them gets access to them. Management, like all things, is an ongoing process. It's a process as you see problems, you work with problems. And we're dealing with that. And the results of management is how many people tragically and unfortunately died, and we've kept that as one of the lowest in the world. How many people were vaccinated, one of the highest in the world, and making sure we've still got access to ICU, working with the states to make sure we've got access to ICU. When the Omicron variant has been so virulent, like, I bet you everybody out there, sometimes before you didn't know anybody had had the COVID virus. Now we know bunches of people with the COVID virus. But we're keeping people alive with massive numbers. We're still managing it. And the rapid antigen tests, they're coming in by the tens of millions. They've been there. It's not as if we haven't had them. We've had heaps of rapid antigen tests in the marketplace, but they sell out. And now we've got to manage that process in a little bit more of a diligent form. That's what governments do. And we'll be judged by success or fail at the end by this. Did you keep people alive that would otherwise have died? Did you manage to keep your ICU beds at a state level under control? Did you do the right thing to try and drive vaccination rates as high as possible? And Australia is one of the highest in the world. And I mean, that's ultimately, if I got to the end, if I had a choice for saying, Did I get a rapid antigen test as quickly as I would like? Well, I'd like that. Or am I alive? I go, yeah, being alive. That's kind of important to me.
I just have a couple of questions from the network on that note, if you don't mind.
Sure.
Why did the government decide to start free rapid antigen test programs to pharmacies today when pharmacies say they won't have supplies for weeks?
Well, we've had supplies of rapid antigen testing coming in. It's just that the demand for them, and in some instances, people hoarding them, has meant that they've been flying off the shelves. Now, next week, we have 16 million tests turning up. 16 million. And so pharmacists will be needed, because we want to make sure that those who are most in need get access to them first, and who are most vulnerable get access to them free. We're doing this in such a way as to get ourselves to a process where ultimately COVID, unfortunately, globally, it's not going anywhere. We're living with it. This is it. And so we've got to get to a process where we get back to work, get back to normal life as quickly as possible, noting that if we're waiting, it's like wishing the flu away. It's not going to happen. We've got it. It's going to hang with us now for, unfortunately, forever.
On the hoarding issue, are you suggesting that everyday Australians are to blame for the rat shortage? Is the government?
No, I'm not. I'm just saying it's a factor of life. There has been some hoarding. I mean, the obvious one is toilet paper. Is there some bizarre reason where all of a sudden there's a spike in demand for toilet paper? No, people hoard it. You know, I don't know whether maybe they go out there and go two bottoms. I don't know. But ultimately, they hoard it. And if they didn't hoard it, we wouldn't be running out of toilet paper. And there have been some instances of hoarding of rat tests. And if they hadn't hoarded it, other people who would have got one, who wanted one, would have got one. Now, I'm not saying it's entirely because of that, but I'm saying it's definitely part of that.
And why has it been left to pharmacies to secure the supplies for the rollout and the government hasn't given them rats to provide
protection? Well, ultimately, we have to make sure that the market, as I said, COVID's going to be with us forever. And private enterprise is a better way of dealing with these issues. I mean, ultimately, we have to source these things from overseas. The government can't become business for our nation. It's got to play its part, but ultimately the process has to work without government. And we're helping it now, but in the future, you know, it's got to go back to the process that has always worked with other drugs, with other requirements that people have. And it's also a case of the government can't pick up the tab for everything. We've got to pick up the tab that's critical, because when people think that they get something from the government for free, it's not. It just goes on the credit card, which is the government's debt, then you have to pay back. So, you know, we've got to make sure, and people say, oh, well, they don't like that message. My job as a politician is to be straight with you. I'm saying that we pay for the vulnerable, we look after the vulnerable, but for myself, for Sam, for James, Brooke, for Nell, Taylor, they don't get it for free. No, you don't get it for free. You pay for it. You pay for it. A person who's doing it tough, I don't know, Hexham, look after them.
One final question, sorry. Some people on concession are being told they'll get $10 plus GST reimbursement, quoted $33 for a pack of rat tests. How is that going to cover costs?
Well, it's certainly going to, look, I'm not going to go into particulars of the cost. I'd have to take that question on notice, but what I could say is it still sounds like most things, if there's a small gap, it's vastly better than the full cost. Is that it?
Okay. I
might just confirm one bit around the Hexham. So just with regard to the Hexham widening, that is part of the funding co-contribution model. And I do acknowledge we can't build legacy infrastructure without the Commonwealth. And I do acknowledge the Deputy Prime Minister here today on this project, or the Pacific Highway, or the Coffs Harbour bypass and tunnel that we're going to build. We can't do this unless we work together. And I acknowledge the 80-20 funding arrangements that are in place that will actually allow us to build this legacy infrastructure. The Hexham widening will occur over the course of this project. We should see works on that in late 2022. It is a separate project, but it comes from the same funding pool. Also, it is important to note that the Commonwealth have come, you know, at the request of New South Wales, have been able to deliver $80 million in additional funding. So this is an update today from the state and federal governments on where this project is at, because a lot of people want to see progress on it. They want to know where it's up to. You don't build roads like this without a lot of planning and with a lot of involvement and, at the end of the day, a lot of cash. And you need both state and federal governments to do that. But it is important to note that the tendering process will open in over the coming month or two. That will last for 6 months, and we'll start to see some real progress once our tenderers are appointed, and we'll start to see some activity on site, which I think it will be very, very valued by everyone, not only across the Hunter, but also right across New South Wales.